Now we'll go to the next holistic approach, Steno to Chennai by Dr. Samit and Dr. Rajiv Kumar.
So what we saw right now is that 300 second opinions could not treat one patient in from Calcutta.
Being presented by someone from Mumbai. and still couldn't give you a solution.
Yes. So,
you
know. So Samit has been ill. He was down with a flu and a bad tummy last week.
Thanks to you.
Thanks to CID.
Yeah.
And he seems to be better, but infectious diseases are out of the window now. Nobody gets, it's not a prolonged illness. It's the non-communicables which have come in, and probably that's what we're going to talk about. And Steno too, it's like there was a movie. Which one was it? Chandni Chowk to China, and this is now Steno 2 to Chennai. Mono, isn't this your most favorite racist dance song?
That's when he used to be dark.
So, this is black or white. So, we are going to extrapolate some white data to, I wouldn't call Chennai black population or probably mauled here, but we are going to extrapolate some of the data to, and see that whether we can fix it in our patients in Chennai.
Yeah. So, I think When Dr. G. Vijay Kumar gave us this topic, we were thinking, what is the meaning of Steno 2 to Chennai? We just couldn't understand the logic behind it. So before Steno 2, we had a lot of trials. Because you see, the whole argument before us, what was going on, was add another drug, add another drug, add another drug. And why was that? Because we have to bring the sugars down. You know, the irony of the whole diabetes management, we still don't know what is our target HbA1c. We still don't know which fasting and PP sugar target we should achieve. And we are debating on molecules and medicines and combination and basal bolus.
And we've been sugar-centric in our approach. We've been dry. We believe that we get the sugar down, we can reduce cardiovascular disease, we can reduce diabetic kidney disease, we can reduce retinopathy, we can reduce amputations. And that has made all of us diabetologists, our bread, butter and champagne is because of sugar. But probably we need to do a lot more to prevent a lot of other complications.
Another reason we are thankful to Dr. Vijay Kumar is, if you look at all the guidelines and then they summarize all the data and says your A1C should be less than 6.5 or patient's A1C should be less than 7, they have all stopped at 2008. And none of the guidelines have included Steno 2 as an evidence to tell us what to do. So we need to talk a little bit about Steno 2. It was the first multifactorial intervention. None of the others were, as Steno 2 was, and I think...
Samit, you're right, in terms that we've had a lot of studies which showed single factor intervention and nothing changed. You know, we needed a Steno 2 to open our eyes and show us that probably we need a multifactorial approach, because patients become diabetes not because they eat a lot of sugar.
Yeah.
You know, and there are multiple factors which are involved in the pathogenesis.
Do you know why this area is more important than this area? If I and you base our sugar management today based on anything before Steno 2, do you know what the microvascular complications were? Reduction in cataract surgery. How many of us treat type 2 diabetes and bring HbA1c less than 7 to reduce cataract surgery? That's UKPDS. Significant reduction in cataract surgery. These are not our aims.
True.
After 2008. We don't treat patients to reduce cataract surgery. So things have changed after 2008. And what changes happened is something I think Steno 2. Take them
True.
Through Steno 2. And do a better job than Manoj, please.
And hopefully the patient in Calcutta gets treated better after 10 or 2. So we've all realized that single risk factor intervention in many RCTs have not shown any kind of improvement other than microvascular complication. So Steno 2 was one of the first study which looked at targeted, intensified, multifactorial intervention over a period of time and as compared to conventional treatment, and whether we could actually help in reducing what we are actually worried about. Because UKPDS left at, they told us that 1% reduction could cause a 25% reduction in microvascular disease. But we are all concerned about macrovascular disease. Our patients are dying of macrovascular disease. And UKPDS left to this legacy effect, the post-trial data follow-up, which told us that probably emergent risk reductions will occur when we control them aggressively. We needed a trial to tell us that what is the way that we reduce cardiovascular disease as well as microvascular complication. So targeted intensive multifactorial intervention versus conventional regimen was what was attempted. And you had
type 2 diabetics with microalbuminuria. This is way back in 2008. And this evaluated the effect on micro and cardiovascular disease of a multifactorial intensified targeted intervention over a period of time. And you had an intensive phase for close to 7.8 years. So this was the study design. And you had five major papers coming out of it. One in the Lancet, which was I think in 2001 or 2002. Then the two in NEJM, which looked at the follow-up of at 13.3 years, at 7.8 years, and then a 5.5 year of follow-up. Then we had two papers coming in 2016 and 18, which was a 21.2 years of follow-up of these patients. So we have a study which looked at the same population over two decades. And there's a wealth of evidence that one can get, though the numbers in the Steno 2 study was very little. There were 160 patients. But the wealth of evidence that one can get from these 160 patients who are followed up over almost 21.2 years is enormous. And that's what we would like to...
I think Samar was asking a question today that most of these trials are 2 or 3 years duration. How do you assess cardiovascular outcomes? True. Look at Steno.
Look at Steno, yes. So Steno 2 had a baseline BMI of 30, HbA1c of 8.8. You had patients who had almost 1/4 had cardiovascular risk factors, duration of diabetes approximately 6 years. And again, two groups, patients with type 2 diabetes with microalbuminuria, then put on intensified or conventional regimen. And these were the drugs the patients were put on. ACE inhibitors were put in the intensive regimen irrespective of blood pressure control, lipid management, again a lot of psychotherapy, cessation of smoking, a complete lifestyle change, a complete holistic approach is what was seen in the Steno 2. You like to add something?
I think the reason we are going into this nitty-gritty details of Steno 2 is not only understanding Steno 2, but as I think Dr. Krishna Ashadi was talking about, understanding how to decode a particular trial and coming. Mm-hmm. It's so easy to say, you know, Steno 2 targeted a multifactorial intervention and we got so much of benefit. But then if you look at these details, it's very important. What were the patient population selected and how do we then interpolate or extrapolate this data into a clinical practice? So that's what we'll be trying to do in the next...
So in your standard regimen, you had a difference of 20 millimeters. This is what was targeted. We'll see what they achieved over a period of time. And if you look at it, ACE inhibitors in the intensive group was irrespective of blood pressure. Aspirin again to patients with known any kind of cardiovascular disease. So at the end of 4 years, what did we achieve? We achieved a lot of reduction in microvascular complications. You know, where is Dr. Sheshadri is gone. So this is relative risk reduction, not absolute risk reduction. But the end of the study, you had a 20% absolute risk reduction in Steno 2. It's not just relative risk reduction. So any study with single risk factor intervention, whether it's a lipid like a 4S or a lipid study or a hypertension study like HOT or SHEP, has given only 5 to 7% maximum absolute risk reduction. This multifactorial gave us a 20% absolute risk reduction. And if you look at the relative risk reduction at the end of 4 years, 70, 55, and 69 in terms of neuropathy and microvascular complications. There was a revision. There was a revision in 2001 that they did, that even in the conventional arm, they decided to target a 6.5. In the intensive arm, it was always less than 6.5. But even in the conventional arm, they decided to target a 6.5. How many of you all believe that?
No, let's take a recess. So we have presented to you a summary of Steno 2. So with this, from today onwards, how many of you are convinced that the target HbA1c for all our patients should be less than 6.5? Can we have a show of hands?
So what's the difference between APART and Steno?
So we'll just come to that,
we'll
sir.
Come to that, sir.
We'll just come to that. We'll come to that, sir, because if you answer
we have a slide on Accord and Steno. The next slides, I think.
No, is the drugs used are different from Accord and the Steno 2, or it is the multiple intervention which has made, even Accord also they gave sufficient drugs to look at the patient's blood pressure, lipids. But when they target less than 6.5 in Accord, the mortality goes up. But you know,
sir, can I just intervene? We have the flow. We will come to that, and you can come and.
Okay, fine. So, we'll okay.
Just, so we'll both Accord and Steno 2 were strategy trials, and not drug trials. And we are coming to that. In our subsequent slides, we have on Accord what went wrong and what Steno 2 what went right.
So, how many would agree with less than 6.5 after such impressive data from Steno? Can we have a show of hand, please? And how many of you will still stick to less than 7? So still large majority. So you didn't convince Steno till
no,
now. Come on.
That's what Steno 2 never told us to go like cowboys in the Accord study. Accord study tried to start from where the UKPDS left off. They wanted to go much below 6 and see that if we reduce and come down below 6, can we reduce cardiovascular disease? Steno, though they attempted to go below 6.5, they didn't reach that value. So that's where we come to.
Your question is, if it is in the initial period, I would say yes.
This is 6 years?
No, six years definitely you will have to reduce. What was the previous target? 8.5. HbA1c. Now you want to reduce it to 6.5. All of them are above 50 to 65 years. I think the goal cannot be achieved.
Okay, right. And you're absolutely right, sir. That's what we're going to show you.
So that's right, that the goal in the Steno 2 in terms of blood sugar control was never achieved. You had a 0.6, 0.6 or 0.7?
We'll come to it.
Yeah, we'll come to it. So at the second presentation of Steno 2, what it showed is that again relative risk reduction, but impressive relative risk reduction in what we're actually concerned about. Cardiovascular disease, chronic kidney disease, and retinopathy. So there is a good amount of significant risk reduction when we do a multifactorial targeted intensified approach in patients with type 2 diabetes with microalbuminuria who are treated aggressively for 7.8 years. So Steno 2 conclusion at the end of 7.8 years was that a target driven intensified and multiple risk factor population with type 2 diabetes and microalbuminuria, you are able to reduce macro and microvascular events by 50%. So though the number treated was lower, it's a huge amount of information that we can get. Now we've heard a lot about legacy effects. Let's have a show of hands that how many actually believe in the legacy effect. Samit, I want your hand also on that.
No, I don't believe that.
Same here. Yeah. So the legacy effect of the UKPDS is where so many patients were intensively treated and then 1,000 patients were observationally seen over a period of 10 years and then shown that probably there is emergent risk reduction in what we look at. So the legacy story, you have the Steno 2 and the Steno 2 follow-up, which we are going to speak about. You have the advance on, the UKPDS follow-up. The DCCT EDIC, probably something one can really believe in because yes. Type 1 diabetes is a very pure medium and probably whatever intervention we do, we are going to get direct results rather than in a type 2 where multiple factors may be involved, you know.
So the only epigenetic effect of the legacy effect has been found from the DCCT trial.
Absolutely.
So that's type
absolutely.
1.
Absolutely. So after the intensive 7.8 years, you had a follow-up after 5.5 years of follow-up. Interesting part in the follow-up was the patients who were in the conventional arm, almost the mortality rate was close to 50%. So out of 80 patients, only 40 patients made up over 5.5 years after the initial trial, which again tells us that when we use a conventional multifactorial approach, a lot of patients do not survive. So patients with type 2 diabetes, average age in the late 50s, when actually you could survive for another 15 years, 50% did not survive after the trial ended and for the next 5.5 years. So at the end of 13.3 years of follow-up, again, all-cause mortality, again, there's a 46% reduction in all-cause mortality. Again, you can understand that after the trial ending, there was a convergence of the risk factors. You know, you were not intensively followed up and targeted then. There was a convergence of risk factors, but again, probably because of benefit earlier or the system was under good control earlier, you got a 46% reduction. This is their paper which came up in 2016. about the number of years gained after an intensive targeted multifactorial approach. The average lifespan in India is, I think, 65 or 66. How much is it in Calcutta? 55, I believe. So the legacy story says that if you control them very aggressively, initially, you can have almost 8 years of increased lifespan over a period of time. And this is a publication in Diabetology, I believe, in 2016. Again, we've been talking about a lot of heart failure. You know, SGLT2s have got heart failure right into our face. You know, you keep on talking about heart failure. But again, that paper in 2018 told us that probably you have an intensified multifactorial approach and you can cause close to 70% reduction. Again, relative risk reduction, but a 70% reduction in heart failure and hospitalization. So Steno2 over a period of 2 decades told us you control multifactorial interventions, you control all risk factors, including cessation of smoking, LDL, blood pressure, cholesterol, give ACE inhibitors to patients who do not have blood pressure, use aspirin early, and you can have a 50% reduction in cardiovascular and microvascular complication at the end of the study, and the emergent risk reduction keep on coming in. So after 2 decades of following up these patients, you're getting a lot of reduction in cardiovascular as well as microvascular complications.
So this is sort of a summarizing the Steno2, the 2 decades that Rajiv just presented to you. You know, it's a huge amount of work presenting 2 decades in 10 minutes, but this is a plethora of data that was accumulated with these agents. Now, what we need to understand is, do you find this impressive or not? And how many of you find this data impressive? Okay. Well, I expect it. Thank you. Now, what is interesting to find, which aspect of this multifactorial intervention? There was ABC, HbA1c, blood pressure, and cholesterol. Which one do you think, or all of them do you think contributed to whatever benefits? How many of you think it was contributed by trying to bring down the HbA1c to less than 6.5? Okay. How many of you think it was because of blood pressure and the cholesterol that has happened? So if you look here,
the answer is there.
Answer is there. Less than 15% of patients, as Sir was pointing out rightly, achieved their HbA1c of less than 6.5. The end of trial HbA1c in Steno2 trial was 7.6. That is the mean HbA1c achieved in this trial. So I come back to the old question from Steno2 when some guideline says like, AS, bring it down to less than 6.5. That I think was a wrong conclusion drawn. Because end of study, Steno2 A1C was 7.6, not less than 6.5. Rather, 70% of the patient actually achieved their cholesterol and blood pressure targets, which tells us whatever impressive data we got from Steno2 was because of more statin use, because of better use of ACE-ARB, not necessarily because of A1C reduction, or as I think Rajiv was pointing out, maybe the drugs used had their limitations because of hypoglycemia. You couldn't even up-titrate to the amount of dose that you wanted to do.
So it was the antihypertensive followed by the statins followed by the antidiabetics actually would make any difference.
So from Steno2, our final voting, how many of you now think that for all our patients we should
have tried? So this is a debate last year, if anybody remembers.
So last
we
debate,
debated on the same topic last year here. You know, so he's come back with it that how many agree with an HbA1c below 6.5?
If it is from the beginning, I can accept 6.5, less than 50 years. If the persons are above 50 years, so 7 will be the ideal one.
Yeah. So again, we will now go to Accord Advanced VADT, and what we are trying to show you, there is no evidence that less than 6.5 gives you any advantage, rather than even 7 to 7.5 has same advantage as less than 6.5. So it raises a very basic question, why even try to go below 6.5? So we'll come to it now. So lessons from after Steno2, let's see additional lessons. If you look at Steno, it had the sugar arm, the BP arm, the lipids arm. And I think what is the most important lesson we have learned from Steno2, please prescribe statins to your patients and be aggressive with the blood pressure control. Because with molecules being discussed in all the meetings, GLP-1 and fast-acting insulin and SGLT-2, we are forgetting some basics which can make a big difference, which are beyond glycemic control. We can do it very easily. We can demonstrate this to our patient. True. Imagine telling your patient, you know, I'm going to give you an SGLT2 and the NNT of your cardiovascular death is 40. What does my patient understand? or your MACE is going to go down. What does my patient understand? But if I can show that your BP has come down from 160 to 130, or your LDL cholesterol is now 70 or less, I can show that in the paper, a patient will be happy and we can translate that data. That is what Steno-2 taught us.
I think the compliance with statins are so poor that we probably need to put a lot of risk scoring when we put statins, and so that patient continues statins for lifelong.
So now coming to, I think, the question of Accord Advanced, VADT and the rest. This slide actually summarizes everything. The data that we got from Accord Advanced, VADT, Steno-2, and we always forget, there are two very large UK PDS like trial done in 2011 and 17, Addition Europe and J-DO-IT-3 from Japan. Huge data like UK PDS. So you accumulate everything. What you find is that with less than 6.5, the only endpoint difference that was made in all the trials was new onset persistent macroalbuminuria. That is the only endpoint you can reduce. But if you look at the A1C between 7.1 to 7.7, you can reduce retinopathy, macroalbuminuria, non-fatal stroke, all-cause mortality. So now, which should be our target? Why even less than 7 is the big question being asked today. A reasonable target we can all achieve, 7 to 7.5, hypoglycemia won't happen, easy to achieve, and we can get all the benefits. Why not? As a matter of fact, this is the Accord Advanced sort of a scenario. More than 10 years of diabetic, as sir was pointing out, duration of diabetes more than 10 years, and you try to make it less than 7, you have increase in CV death and all-cause mortality. So entire benefit is nullified. So the question is whether your duration of diabetes is less than 10 years or more than 10 years. 7 to 7.5 is a very reasonable target to achieve. We don't need any guidelines to tell us. We can ourselves look into the data and come to a conclusion, right? So what should be an evidence-based HbA1c target for most of a non-pregnant, uncomplicated type 2 patient? This is now the modern question we should ask, and this is what we should debate more and more rather than falling back.
So GVK is giving a gift, another gift for people to answer this, right? So I'm giving a pointer also.
So we have, I think, indirectly answered the question.
Indirectly answered the
But we question. Can still debate it out. It's not that, I think, instead of spending more money on the drug thing, I think we should get more data on this area. You know, more than 10 years of diabetes and HbA1c more than 7, what are the benefits? There is no data.
Absolutely no benefit.
There is absolutely no data. So we need to invest more money in this area. Now, connecting to Chennai. Now, we will take you to Chennai.
Am I supposed to take Chennai? I thought you were also coming to Chennai. So now we want to see that what the data that we got from Steno-2. Now, how do we get it to Chennai? You know, it's a long flight from Steno-2 to Chennai. But Chennai itself has done a lot of work. Chennai is the mecca of diabetes in India. Unfortunately, you all couldn't treat Samit's patient, but you know, it's the mecca of diabetes. So Chennai has done a lot of work, whether it's epidemiological work or whether it's an intervention or probably a community participation work. So if you look at all these data, so CURES, CUPS, you all have all heard about these studies. Again, Dr. V. Mohan's studies. So here is whether diabetes in Asian Indians, how much is preventable. So this is a 10-year follow-up of the CURE data. And what we see is that you go down directly to the lowest bottom, that if you add on all these things, so if you are overweight, if you have truncal obesity, you have hypertriglyceridemia and low HDL, then 80% of type 2 diabetes in our population can be prevented. So when you have this, this is the metabolic syndrome, and we all know these metabolic abnormalities in patients with these kind of, they drive type 2 diabetes. So 80% of it is related to these metabolic abnormalities. And if you can take care of these metabolic abnormalities, it's a preventable disorder. And probably how do we prevent it? It whether it's lifestyle, drugs, doesn't matter, but you can prevent the onset of diabetes. Now this is the CUPS study, which was the primary prevention study. I'm sure you all are aware of Asiad colony. I'm not aware. I picked up this data from Dr. Mohan. And they looked at two populations, a middle income group, which had close to a monthly income of around 10,000 rupees, and a low income group, which looked at a population of 2,000 to 2,500 rupees. And if you look at it, the middle income group had a prevalence of diabetes of 12%, and the low income group had a prevalence of diabetes of 6.5%. Now, in the middle income group, they decided that probably the prevalence is very, very high as compared to the low income group, and we need to do something. We need to do something to prevent the progression or the increased prevalence or the increased incidence of diabetes which is occurring. So they decided that probably they need to build, with the help of the community participation, they decided to build a park there and make sure that the residents in this middle income group were encouraged to go and exercise in the park. Just some news that none of us exercise a lot, but Samit, every day in his lunch break, for an hour he goes to the gym. So he's blessed like that, that we all probably sleep in the afternoon, but Samit goes to the gym in the afternoon. Right or not? So if you look at it, the exercise baseline was 13.8%. This is in the middle income group population. But at the follow-up, they found that there is a 277% increase in exercise. So by just building a park, you had more people, and these people were exercising more than 4 times a week. So by just doing this, you are able to get more people onto a lifestyle intervention with community participation. And if you look at the prevalence of diabetes in Chennai over the years, it has reached almost 22%. And in age groups more than 65, it's 27 to 28%. So 1 out of 4 individuals here also have type 2 diabetes. So if I just go back to this, initially we looked at somewhere around 12% was the prevalence in the middle income group. But by the time it was 2014, the prevalence had gone up to 22.8 in urban Chennai.
So Rajiv, can I now give a proposal to Dr. G. Vijayakumar? We did it in a very successful thing and got one of our very young friends converted into an uncle. But that was the issue was, if you have such a gathering, next time just keep a plan, a routine blood pressure and a random sugar check among all the physicians. It was a revelation which happened. A lot of people benefited when we did in one of our CMEs. Obviously, it came as a shock to a lot of us and our friends. But I think this data also points that when we are listening, we should use this. Do it in a systematic fashion so that,
Then you can collect data and then you can present it next year.
It was done in Cochin by Noah Nardesek. We are surprised to see 9.4, 10.5 among the physicians.
Yes, true, sir.
A1C levels.
True. And maybe a lot of them may be newly diagnosed also then.
Nobody had a level less than 6.5.
Yeah, absolutely.
When that is the case with the doctors, what will happen to the patient community?
I completely agree with you, sir. So coming back to our story, the middle income group had a 12.4%. And you know that 2014, it had jumped to around 22% prevalence. So with the help of intervention, it went up to only 15.4%. That means there was just a little bit of rise when the rest of Chennai had gone up to 22%. But in the low income group, which was 6.5% to start off, without any intervention, they had gone up substantially higher, which basically means that everyone is at risk, whether you're low income, below poverty line, high income, elite, everyone is at risk. So the low income group, which was not, we didn't involve any intervention or a community participation in this, their prevalence went up by 135%. And that is something that we need to look at. So whether whatever be the income source, it doesn't matter. Patients need to be having some sort of lifestyle changes. Again, if you look at the profile of long-term survivors versus non-survivors in patients with type 2 diabetes, and this is a paper by Dr. V. Mohan published 6 years back, and it was a retrospective data. They looked at 200,000 patients from their database, and patients who were diagnosed young and patients who lived for more than 40 years. You know, so the long-term survivors were more than 40 years. So age at diagnosis was matched, sex was matched, and then seen over a period of time that who survived and who didn't survive with a retrospective data. Somebody would like to ask this question?
Yes. So, you know, after having discussing all those risk factors and things, now these two slides are extremely important. We have been, in all the CMEs, we have been presented with cardiovascular outcome trials. You know, everything is matched. Sugar is matched, BP is matched. One gets an SGLT2, other gets placebo, and huge differences in MACE, this, that. What percentage of patients do you think in those trials had their A, B, and C under target? Because if your A, B, and C is not under target with steno to tortoise, then how can you extrapolate and tell us that the molecule had such big benefit?
True.
So how many think 15% in such well-conducted RCTs had their ABC under target? So voters for 15%. Is voting season elections? Come on, be spontaneous. How many of you? Okay. How many of you will vote for 30%? Okay. 50%? 80 to 100%? So it's all around the place. It's split. Well, let's see. This is ticostral with sitagliptin. And see what they write. Less than 30% of patients met the metabolic target.
This is in a cardiovascular trial.
In a randomized controlled cardiovascular trial, less than 30% of patients are achieving their ABC. You know, this tells us what we can do to much improve their outcomes beyond the molecules which are under focus today. Only 30% of patients have achieved that. And look at this. If you look at HbA1c, LDL cholesterol, and BP, it's a very recent data from Diabetes, Obesity, Metabolism, 2019. It's an international 48 countries data accumulated together. Only 15% of patients are achieving that. And if you include, along with that, smoking, all four, only 13% of patients are achieving that. So even real life, if this is what is happening, we can make a huge difference looking out here rather than, you know, focusing on the molecules primarily.
True.
And this is Dr. Ramchandran's data, again, a very recent data which has come from multicentric, multiple population. 7 waves of data has come looking at what difference has been made to the complications. So just look at the micro and macrovascular complications. And look what reduction has been there. 30-40% reduction. 60% risk is still out there, which we have not yet addressed. Look at macrovascular. Only 20% or 10% reduction has happened. And this can be achieved with what Steno 2 taught us. And that is not being discussed at all in any meetings, thank you. That is not been discussed or even included in any trials as an evidence for making their guidelines. Shameful for whichever testers they are.
I would agree.
So, you know, lessons that we have learned from all this discussion from Steno 2 to Chennai is more effort needs to be put in to accomplishing the cardiometabolic targets. And then we need for a holistic approach, not only a glucose-centric approach. Glucose is the weaker link of the three. Or the four, smoking, blood pressure, cholesterol are the stronger links. And lower down comes glucose. We can relax it a bit if you want. Approach and choice of combination of medicines. Yes, we can definitely, while choosing the combination of anti-hyperglycemic, include those which makes an outcome benefits. And periodical self-audit is extremely important. You and me will have to audit ourselves as individuals and as groups. Only then we can make a substantial improvement. Thank you very much.
Wow. All of you will agree that this is one of the very good sessions that we had. And I think Samit and Rajiv, I think you did beyond what I was expecting, frankly speaking.
But I have a final disclaimer. I have been the punching bag of the Mumbaikars for a long time. And I'll tell you the reason. This is jealousy. Economics Times, if you want, I'll just send the WhatsApp to you just now. Economics Times have just published the data of all four metros, and Kolkata has come first in achieving A1C by doing much lesser tests than what Mumbai can do.
Kolkata,
we do much lesser tests and you have better HbA1c.
8.5 and 8.34.
Rajiv, don't say that it's a biased result.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.